am already in progress.
In to take the draw against Charlie DeFonseca, the two number 10s squaring at it. Lindsay successful, Santillo rip, and he missed wide. There's the rebound, and just like we saw in that first game, the net coming loose a little bit on this side of the ice, so the faceoff will come right back in Woods' end.
And maybe a little bit of an accidentally on purpose play by Woods. Puck goes wide of the net, and he kind of purposely get that net off, although he won't admit it, but he'll draw the faceoff and alleviate that scoring opportunity.
Now Miwa comes in to take the draw instead of Lindsay. We saw Lindsay win it last time, and Woods sprawls out and makes the stop. A little bit of a chop at Woods was from Miwa, but no one thinks anything of it. So now Lindsay will come in and take the draw. A little bit of an interesting development there as they keep rotating their centermen, but it's so important to have such versatile players, multiple guys on a line that can take the draw.
Yeah, you want to have multiple guys just in case someone gets kicked out of the faceoff dot.
Played to the corner. Crawford loses it. Lindsay was in the way. Santilla in there. Had that scoring chance earlier. Coming back to help out is Hoover. Meanwhile, with that backhand sauce to his point man, Santilla centers one off the outside of the net. Lindsay was there. Good pressure here from Richmond Hill. Taken away by Hoover, but not out. Miwa there to provide the pressure up top. Batted down with a glove, and then running over his man is number 52. That is Owen Laffey.
Yeah, and there's Laffey ahead, running over number 6 for Markham. And a little bit of a dangerous play. Looked like it was an accident.
Richmond Hill's been better as of late in the early stages of this hockey game. Also coming off a win, so they're riding a bit of a high horse. Markham, as we mentioned, losing 3 straight, but playing better despite the losses. You'd like that extra goal here and there, that extra bounce to try and get you victorious, but right now these teams tied for the final playoff spot, also with the North Central Predators. So a huge game at stake here between two teams in the West Division. Shot is followed up there, hits the outside of the net. Woods lets it play. Scullion on it now. Loses it. Rogers is going to try and poke this one up. He did, but not out. Good pinch there by the Richmond Hill Coyotes. They'll keep that one in. Rodas. And now back on it. A shot missed wide. First one in there. And now good puck support by Willard to escape. Markham trying to get that good forecheck that we've seen from them all year long. But we haven't really seen it much tonight, just early on in the game. But lately, Richmond Hill has been the better puck management team. They look for an up pass. And Johnson's right there on the intercept. Icing waved off because it was in the way of Johnson. So he plays it to an open corner, but the Coyotes keep it in. Good persistence in the offensive zone. That one hopped over Baker's stick. And Charlie DeFonseca, always back there to help out his defense. Such a great two-way forward. That one stayed in. Schuster kept it in. The pass! And it was just broken up by Johnson. Offensive capabilities, but also the defense on display there. Bad change. And they're going to try and catch them. Here's Lindsay in with a wrister. And just missed wide. Coyotes have to tag up. They have Lindsay down low after that chance. He just missed the glove side, tried to pick it and score the game's first goal. Newman being pressured. That's a great play by the Coyotes. They take control. They try and center one. It was missed, and Skolich back on it. The big winger looking to use his body like he does there, but Schuster getting in the way to break up that pressure. Newman, he'll flip it, but not deep. It was a turnover. And here's Miwa. Miwa now working in. Diving across was Crawford. The net is way off. Lindsay's not happy about it. I can't imagine the Coyotes coaching staff is either.
You can't imagine they are, because Crawford went down diving sprawl and he took that net off its moorings and almost could have been a delay of game, you think. A player trying to take away a scoring opportunity against and takes off the net in the process. Kind of curious there, but no penalty is called. Play ensues. Faceoff coming to the right side Markham goaltender.
I think it's tough to call that an intentional play because of the fact that we saw it 5-6 times in last game. We already seen it twice tonight on that same side. So, I mean, I'm assuming it's just the pegs, but they catch a break nevertheless. But, yeah, you definitely got to be aggravated if you're the Coyotes coaching staff, as Rodas will come in to take this draw against Logan Hoover. Logan has a brother, Keegan Hoover. They don't play on the, or they are on the same line tonight, actually. Last game, we didn't really see them play together, but maybe a three-game losing streak has this coaching staff reevaluating the lines as Wood spears that one from the point, and we'll have a whistle here. 7:04 remaining here in the first, and we got no score.
Well, Richmond Hill's done a really good job of putting pucks towards the net, and you saw earlier on that diving play by Richmond Hill where they knocked off the moorings. That was as a result of Richmond Hill really pressuring. And right now it seems like the puck possession is going to Richmond Hill. What they're doing is they're getting their forwards up, and they make sure that their defensemen don't pinch too much. So they're playing a little conservatively amongst the defensemen, but their offense is aggressive.
Frost won the draw, but taking over are the Coyotes, and they come inches from a goal right there. Is back the other way on the transition. Come the Waxer, Sasaki. Fights for it. Johnson kept it in. He rung it around. Who will get there? It will be Baker. Tries to put one on net, but Fan Rodas back on it now. Center iceman for the Richmond Hill Coyotes will flip it in, and Johnson's got some pressure. Gets it away nicely for Sasaki, who will lift it up. Coyotes take over in the middle of a line change. Now they're going to complete it as they get it deep off of Johnson, but they still got the pressure on. Baker, nice move to get around the forechecker. Coyotes try and put that one deep. Picked up by Blake Frost and now sent down low for Sasaki. Sasaki in the corner, battling with a defenseman bigger than him and draws a penalty. That is probably a hold. They call it a cross check against the Coyotes. So the Waxers, deadly on the power play, will head to its first.
Well, Sasaki's going to draw it. His face was heading toward his own goaltender. He had good positioning on the puck, really good strength, and he was knocked off, but an illegal hit from behind, as you said, a cross check, getting his stick up and crossing him right in that back area. Two or less for the Markham Waxers as they go to the power play.
And a lot of star power on it. They like to stack up that first unit. Sasaki draws the penalty. Logan Hoover's out there with Keegan Hoover, DeFonseca, Skolid, and Johnson. They really like a lot of star powers. There's a scrum, and Johnson's alone in front. He takes the shot stop, and there's a scrum in front of the net. No one knows where it is. Goaltender is facing the other way, but the Coyotes clear it. Close call there. So much star power on this power play. They really like to get a lot of momentum generated on this first unit. If they don't score, try and get it towards the second, but definitely an effective first look for the Waxers. DeFonseca will send this one in. Logan Hoover gives chase. Helped out, a lot of good puck support. Three guys down low. Trying to emerge with it here. 1:08 to play on their man advantage. Scoreless game here on Rogers TV. They finally blow it dead, as no one could really find that puck. But a good job by the Coyotes to keep that puck in the corner after a really dangerous chance.
Yeah, and DeFonseca coming up with the best chance for either team in this game. As if you take a look at it, actually, this is the earlier play as scrum ensues here. And here's DeFonseca with the shot. Incredible save, acrobatic, he got down. And somehow, even though there's a big rebound on the play, puck never went in the back of his net. But that's desperation from your goalie. That's a goalie who wants to make that save, who needs to make that save, and he does everything to make it there.
Woods out to play it, and he does nicely. But Crawford was overcommitted on the other side. Nice to see Doug Crawford getting some power play time coming back from that leg injury. Get him right back into game speed. We've seen a lot of ice time from him so far to start this one. Here's Blake Frost. He will send this one down low. Reeves is in there to give chase. But the Coyotes emerge with this puck. Not able to clear, though. Some puck support to come help it out in the corner. And we've seen a lot of these scrums in this power play. Just a lot of scrums in the corner. No one can really emerge with the puck. But now they do. Baker winds, fires, and he just missed on the glove side. Tried to pick that corner. No screen in front, so he went for it all and just couldn't get it, as the Coyotes will make wholesale changes, as will the Waxers. Baker with that great chance. Logan Hoover will reverse it for his defenseman, Baker, and it was out of the reach of his player, and now a bad bounce off the linesman creates a two-on-two opportunity. Moving on in, the shot, and Sebastian Woods just aggressively throws that shoulder up and makes the big stop.
Well, Baker with just one goal this season, Pierce Baker, number 9 for Markham, and had another great opportunity on the power play, which has just expired for Markham. That puck looked like it beat the goalie, but didn't beat the net. Goalie was sliding a little bit, but he tried a top shelf shot there. Not a bad idea since there's no screen in front of the net.
Adamo Santia had that chance. 6 points in 15 games. That's good enough for third offensively on this team. Vanker now plays this puck up for Logan Hoover with his brother Keegan. Good chemistry there. They try and center it. Willard picks it up. The short windup there was stopped by Barbuto. And now a hooking penalty is going to be coming to Markham. And after that squandered opportunity on the power play, they're going to have to kill one of their own.
Well, momentum changes very quickly, doesn't it? They can't score on the power play. Now they're going to the box. So with just 3 minutes here, as we take a look at this call, and a little bit of a hook, actually held on to his stick, didn't allow him to move as he was trying to cash through center ice there, trying to get some speed up the middle, and he was actually lunged onto, and there's a power penalty coming up.
Interesting that you don't get an offensive zone draw after you draw a penalty. A lot harder to set up in the offensive zone, especially when you got a power play, but they do it anyways. Moving on in, the shot, and Woods sticks that stick out, but the Coyotes, again, that scrum in the corner, but the Coyotes trying to emerge with it. The defenseman Johnson's up high, trying to work this puck out, and they muscle it out. Shuckster now with time, circling back, trying to make something happen here. 3 minutes to play in this first period. We're scoreless. It's the Markham Waxers and the Richmond Hill Coyotes from Angus Glen Community Center. It's minor midget AAA action. A huge one up for grabs. 2 points that will mean so much when it's all said and done between these two squads. Miwa, the speedy small forward, slips a check, and he still got the puck into the corner. Played back for Shuckster. First Santia, back to Shuckster, the one-timer. And that one is up and over Woods. He jumped for it, but fortunately it was over the net and sent all the way down to Matt Barbuto. Santia flying out there tonight for this Richmond Hill team. He crosses center, elects to keep the puck, flips it on in. Rogers there is bodied by Santia, and he's going to get a penalty for it. That was an aggressive check on the forecheck. A little bit too aggressive, though. Interference, the call, and we'll skate 4-on-4 for 30 seconds.
That was a little bit of a silly play by number 10, Ryan Lindsay. He's coming in here. Actually, that's going to be number 92, I'm sorry. And he just hits his man. You're in on an offensive rush. You have an opportunity. You're on the power play. Why are you hitting guys? Try and set something up. A little bit too much, and probably not something that his coach will be too happy about. That's Adamo Santia taking the penalty.
And that was dangerous as well, because Rogers turned his body, and at the second that he turned his body, he got hit from behind. You always want to avoid those neck and collarbone injuries. Here's Miwa as the team skate 4-on-4 after the penalty by Santia. Played down low for Ryan Lindsay. He'll try and center, and broken up by Crawford. Crawford to the corner, but he chases his own puck. Miwa back to get it. You see the skill on display for him. You can tell he's just one of those guys who likes to calm the play down. Plays a very smart and conservative hockey game. Crawford, as he'll play it down, and now it's a power play for the Markham Waxers. Their second try. They're 0-for-1 right now on the man advantage, and again, stacking up the first unit, at least up top. They get Baker, or that's Crawford all alone. The shot, that one missed, and now you got to be careful. Shorthanded for Lindsay, but he's at the end of his shift. He'll flip it down. 1 minute to play on this power play. Crawford being harassed there. On the forecheck, that was Sciara. As DeFonseca will get it now and trying to get their power play set up. 50 seconds to play in the power play. 50 seconds to play in the period as well. And Barbuda will just have none of it and cover up for a draw.
Well, good back check by Richmond Hill. They see Di Fonseca streaking down the middle of the ice. You know he's got so much speed and so much power. What you want to do is try and take away the shooting lanes. He's so dangerous if you can get in the slot and possibly get a shot. So you load up two guys on him. And it works there as he had a very tough angle and backhanded a shot that resulted in an easy stop.
Keegan Hoover is going to come in and take the draw. And he loses it as Richmond Hill emerges with this puck. He will flip it out, and De Fonseca knocked it down briefly. Now left to chase his own puck. Johnson will get it now. 30 seconds to play in both the period and the power play. A scoreless first period, but a pretty entertaining one. Both teams with their share of chances. One's blocked by Johnson. The defenseman's up top, and then he plays it up for Logan Heaver. They've got an opportunity here. The shot is stopped. The rebound! And it was cleared by a defender at the last second. A very smart, wise play to save them from a disaster at the end of the period. Here's Hoover. He'll play it up, but it's intercepted, and time will expire in the first. A close opportunity there for the Waxers to open the score, but we remain scoreless.
Well, for this game, Phil Keston, the head coach of Markham Waxers, talked about the importance of this game because these teams are so close. Also, it's the year that these guys are going to be drafted. And in that first period, we saw a lot of defensive hockey. That's what scouts are looking for. They're looking to see the defense. How do you back check? Not how do you score goals, but how can you be solid in your own zone? And as well, the goaltenders, give them credit. Matthew Barbuto for Richmond Hill, very solid, flashing a couple saves with the leather. And on the other side for Markham, it was Sebastian Woods who got the start here. Interesting, Phil Keston actually likes to rotate his goalies. Talking to him before the game, he likes to put the goalie in who hasn't played the last game unless one of them does not do a great job. And we're seeing some good goaltending from both sides, but a defensive hockey game. And I think that's what we kind of expected to see. You know, no team was really putting too many chess pieces out early, and throughout the whole game, for the first period, we haven't seen too much of that.
Yeah, and I think Sebastian Woods was pretty solid also, and Phil Keston also said that that their goalies have played really well this year. He is able to rely on either goalie in either situation, and in the big game tonight, he goes with Woods, and he hasn't disappointed yet.
No, he has not, and Doug Crawford, another player that you were mentioning, who's back from an injury that set him out for 2 months, and he's been logging a lot of ice time. Big, strong, physical defender. And he's been manning a lot of bodies, not giving Richmond Hill a lot of chances in tight.
Also to mention, Keston called this a must-win game, and it's very early, or at least we think it's early. He knows that there's desperation. Opportunity in front, kicked out twice by Barbuto, and now back the other way come the Richmond Hill Coyotes. They'll flip it in to Fonseca back defensively. Willard in there as well, but the Coyotes still applying that tight forecheck. Willard, one hand on the puck. Coyotes emerge with it for the time being, and Rogers has got it now. A lot of mobility on this back end for the Markham Waxers. All six of their defensemen, it seems, can rush the puck up, score at any time, but also play well defensively.
Yeah, they can play well defensively, as you saw in that last rush. But I'm going to look at Charlie De Fonseca, who had two great chances in the offensive zone there, but he's so smart that he likes to go back and he back checks. He's not one of those centermen that just relies on goal scoring. He tried to score, two opportunities missed, and he back checks hard. You love to see a player if you're a coach, Phil Keston.
This is the best line that the Coyotes have rolled out all night. The line of Santia, Miwa, and Ryan Lindsay rotating their centermen on this line, but overall, they've generated the most offensive zone time and the most possession for this team. So these are three players that they really look to drive the ship for this team.
Yeah, Miwa particularly, real small guy, but he's very skilled, and we see how crafty he is when he has speed in transition, and he's so small that he can actually go underneath guys. So Miwa for me has been excellent.
Here he is now playing it off for Laffey. He'll look for Santia, and now back for Laffey. He's got his defense partner who plays it up. Miwa with that clever chip, but a bit too far, and Baker on it now. Pierce Baker, the high stick by Miwa is called, and now this faceoff will come outside, but clever little play there to try and get some offensive zone time.
Yeah, you want to try and sustain offensive zone. Something we haven't seen in this game, as we take a look at the replay, puck just tipped on, and it was touched with a high stick, as that was called, but a clever play, trying to get that puck back to the point. We haven't seen a lot of shots from the point. Try and get some bodies in front, and maybe screen a goalie for for school this hockey game.
We were talking today earlier about small players and how it doesn't matter how small or big you are, but really your skill set, your hockey sense. It seems like Adam Miwa has both of those traits.
Yeah, Miwa does have both of those traits, and so does one of the Hoovers. Keegan Hoover, one of the stronger, taller guys, who's actually his brother, Logan Hoover, who's not as strong, but he's very mobile, and as you said with Miwa, very elusive, very able to go underneath guys, escape the checks. And he's feisty. You better watch out for him with all that speed in the neutral zone.
Faceoff is won. Eliopoulos playing across. Rodas tried a shot, but it was blocked by his own man. Now a race to the corner. And coming back to help out Sasaki defensively. Eliopoulos a shot. That one's blocked as well. And Newman now being hounded on this shift, but the Coyotes keep pressure. Now Vanker finds his man Sasaki. There's a foot race for it, but getting the step there is Eliopoulos, the big defenseman with the long reach. Still a scrum there, kicked out. Now Vanker's got it now for Markham. Will throw it in. That one's deflected up and out of play by Matt Barbuto. So we're 2 minutes into this period and we still got no score, but what have you seen so far that you like from the Markham Waxers?
Well, I like their first line with the Hoovers and with Charlie DeFonseca. They've had a lot of scoring opportunities, but I want to see them pressure more with their support guys. We were talking before the game. It's one thing for that top line to be good, and I believe they have. Let's see what the rest of the guys can do.
Depth is absolutely important. You need a good supporting pass. Ring around works. Here's Early on it. He shoots, and Woods makes the stop. Good chance for Early there, early in the second period.
Well, we were talking about small guys who maybe aren't as strong or physical, and that's kind of what Early is there, is he has a lot of speed along that right side, and not much of a chance as the goaltender, Barbuco, comes out to make the easy stop.
I'm telling you right now, I'm not going to be able to avoid those puns with Early. That is a great last name, and especially in a game like hockey, where you got to be early on everything, or at least right on time. Anticipation is absolutely key. That one is played up. Shuckster throws it up. No stick there to touch it, but no icing as Woods is out to play it, reverses it nicely for Rogers, who sends it back up. A nice pass for Scullett. He tried the return for DeFonseca, and Early will flip it in. Rogers, nice mobile defenseman out there with Willard, his defense pairing, the partner, should I say. DeFonseca's got a step on this one. Nice back pass. Here's Scullett moving in. He scores! What a set of hands from the big man. And Scullett opens the scoring here in the second period. Markham's up 1-0.
Scullett with so much speed. He's like a bull running through the middle. Number 55. He goes inside, then he goes outside. Yeah. The goalie was a little deked out there. He thought the puck was going one way, and as you mentioned, a great set of hands. The goaltender might have thought that a big guy like Scholes, he might go for the shot. He might try and go for a big slapper, but he goes right in, a nice backhand to finish off that goal.
How about Robert Scholes moving in? Big body, so he's very aggressive with the speed. Uses his body to get position in front of the net. Just slips it to the backhand through the legs of Barbuto. 1-0 Markham Waxer lead here in the second period. And they'll look for more in this very important game. Insurance is everything. You can't hold back on the score sheet. As Miwa comes back the other way, dancing through, looking to even the score. Miwa walks in. A great defensive play by Baker. That one's thrown back. Lindsay's on it. Shot, and Woods makes the stop. He needs to shut it down for the next few minutes, you think. You saw in the first game of our doubleheader how important it was to follow up a goal with a good shift, or else it burns you.
Well, yeah, and a good shift after the goal. That was Miwa. We talked about him so much this game, and his speed, and not just his speed, it's his craftiness, because he comes in along the right side with speed, and then he shifts to the left side, and as you mentioned, Baker diving to take away that chance.
Pass in front, what a stop by Woods, and now a penalty coming to the Markham Waxers. You had to take that penalty to negate the chance. It's a hook in front of the net and a second opportunity on the power play for the Coyotes.
Well, the Coyotes had one power play, did not score, but they are deadly and they'll go back to it here. Opportunity in front, there's the save. And it's actually right there after the initial save where it's like a little stick comes up and it's Markham going to the box. Two or less on the power play for Richmond Hill. looking to tie this game up and starting to put some momentum on after they allowed that goal.
I think that hook was in the corner, so my apologies for that. That was before the centering pass, and a great spot there from Woods. But Eliopoulos has got it now on the man advantage. Richmond Hill, after going down early in this second period, has an opportunity to tie things up. Eliopoulos backtracking. Hill will play it up. Barassa threw it in. Rogers giving chase, but he's hounded. Willard in to help out. Comes right back for the skater. Rogers again, a little scrum. You got to think that it's one of these two team strategies to have these scrums. Chance for Woods, making the stop back in front. Here's an opportunity. They score.
Yeah, and that time Woods never picked up that puck on the centering pass. Woods never saw it. As we mentioned, one of those teams, maybe one of their plans was to initiate a scrum. The scrum results in this, a nice pass out in front, and Woods looked like he never saw the puck, because it was a savable puck toward his far side, but he picked it up a little late, and not all that impressive of a shot, but an important one, tying this game at 1-1 and generating some momentum, getting on the power play, now scoring.
Christos Rodas is going to get the goal. Woods made the stop, puck came to the other side, and he was just moving laterally too much, as right back comes Richmond Hill looking for the lead. The pass back, here's Sorrentino. He'll rip one, and a redirect by Reed, but an unbelievable acrobatic stop by Woods. That one could have been 2-1 in a hurry.
That was the save of the game so far. That is such an underrated save, folks. You can't see that here, but if you were to see that, that's just an incredible save, because that puck was deflected at the last second, and a goalie has to be so acrobatic. It looks like it's going to be an easy stop on the shot from the point, and then at the last second, he actually just snatched leather and totally saved the goal there.
Bailing out his team for being on their heels a bit too long, it seems, as Baker will chip it up the boards. Waxers need some offensive zone time here. They weren't able to follow up their first goal with an insurance marker, so we're tied now. Almost 5 minutes into this second period, 1-1, and such an important game.
Definitely important, as you mentioned, these teams tied in their same division, and they're looking to try and get into that fourth spot. And a couple players stood out for me, including Adam Miwa, number 88. He leads Richmond Hill in points. He's had a great game today. And Ethan Eliopoulos has done a nice job on defense, taking away chances from in tight.
Played to the corner, but Johnson will chip that puck back. Skalid scored the goal for Markham, and then scoring the goal for Richmond Hill was Christos Rodas on that shot that he looked like he fanned on, but it was perfect placement. Not quite the same level of skill as Skalid's, but that's not what matters. It's about how many, as that one's deflected out of play by Barbuto. We are tied 1-1 here in the second. What is Richmond Hill going to have to keep doing? Do they stick with this game plan? Do you think this game plan is going to cut it out for them, or are they going to have to make some adjustments?
I think they'll have to make some adjustments, maybe take some more chances. They only have one or two forwards playing up in Richmond Hill's zone. I'd like to see all three guys, maybe even a defenseman pinching in. They haven't done enough to generate opportunities, and now that they scored that goal, Richmond Hill is now on the attack, so maybe opportunity for Markham to try and refocus their attack.
Rodas, the goal scorer, got kicked out of the draw, plays it back. Centering try went to no one, and now a little bit of miscommunication, and back come the Coyotes. Draw pass, the shot, and Woods sticking out that glove once again. It kind of seems like the puck has a magnet towards Sebastian Woods' glove. He's able to just stick that glove out and makes the stop so easily.
He's made so many great plays, but that all started because of a defensive miscommunication, as it looked like one of the Markham Waxers players was about to touch that puck, and then he went back from the puck as if one of his line mates was going to touch the puck. It resulted in a play the other way, but you got to be in communication with your other teammates.
Communication is such a key, especially in a game like this. Eliopoulos, the slapper, and Woods looked behind him but had the puck the entire time. He's a steady goaltender, isn't he?
Very steady. See him getting good reads to these pucks, except for that goal, which he never actually saw the puck on that. He's made such good reads getting to the puck, and just solid. You don't see him acrobatic and flailing everywhere. He's just solid, almost like a Carey Price.
But he's shown his athleticism tonight as well with a couple of stops. A 2:32 goals against average on the year for Sebastian Woods as his net comes off. And with 14:09 remaining in this period, you see, it says 14:20 on the scoreboard, but game clock reads 14:09. There it is. And we'll have a draw again in the Markham zone. How do you think Markham's been playing in their defensive end in terms of their forwards coming back and helping out?
I think they're doing a good job so far. But I'd like to see them pressure a little bit more, try and get their forwards up a little higher.
Opportunity, and Woods once again makes the stop. Logan Hoover in to save things. For the time being, Keegan lifts it with one hand. A lot of close calls around the net of Sebastian Woods, but he's able to keep it out. That one looked dangerous. Both players seem to be okay. Rogers plays it up. Prez in the way of that. He'll play it back for Eliopoulos, who's being pressured by both Hoovers. And no one getting there except for Keegan Hoover, who will flip it in. And Logan, his brother, gives chase. Eliopoulos tried to drop it for someone. No one there. Logan will play it for Keegan. Keegan, the wraparound, tried to center. Rogers shoots. That one's blocked. Rebound. Scores! Logan Hoover right on the spot. 2-1, Markham.
Well, that's a goal scorer's goal. He was in the right place at the right time. Not all that pretty, but you could see that goal coming in fast forward time because he was right there in the right place at the right time. Puck's going to carry him off the sidewall, and maybe there's some debate as to whether that puck crossed the line before or after the moorings fell off. No debate here. It's a goal, and the Hoovers continue to dominate for Markham.
And it all starts with that forecheck, the forecheck that has been so effective for them all year long. A big reason why they win the games that they win. And that's what gives them the lead right there. A little bit of puck luck, but when you got guys in the right areas, that's all you really need. Skolid's got it now. Allen's picked off, and Johnson's got it. He will try and flip it in, but finishing his hit and blocking it is Santia. Laffey, but Skolid in the way, having a strong game. DeFonseca. Here's Laffey. DeFonseca threw his man down. No call. A little bit of more aggressive play as Santina delivers a hit on Johnson. And then Skolid goes after Laffey. Skolid's on it now. He'll try the behind-the-back pass, but Santia was right in the way. I think Santia's been the most effective player for Richmond Hill tonight, hasn't he?
Yeah, Santia's done a great job for Richmond Hill. He's big and strong. What he's done this game is he really moved the puck well, trying to get it to his wingers as a centerman. What I love to see is his physical play, and we're seeing it, and it starts with Skolid, the big, bad, strong forward for these Markham Whackers. A lot of bodies being thrown around. You know how important this game is? We've reached the midway mark, and I expect to see even more physical action between these teams.
We'll see if that happens. Definitely been nothing short of entertaining so far. As the Hoover line right back on it. Logan gave chase, but intercepted by Richmond Hill. Eliopoulos has got it now in his own zone. He'll play it to the other side. And it'll be dumped in on Willard's side, and Baker back to get it. There's a lot of chemistry on this Waxer team, especially between the Hoovers. And it's evident in every single game that they play. You know, they're always finding each other in the open spots and doing a great job of it.
It was our second game calling on Roger CV amongst this team, and they like to find each other. One's the centerman, one's the winger, and they find each other. One of them is a little bit more crafty. That's Logan, and then Keegan Hoover, bigger, stronger body, but they both complement each other so well.
I think even the defense, too. They communicate while they're on the ice. They make smart, quick plays to each other. Very effective when you got a fast game going like this. Effective when you go to the Ontario Hockey League or the Ontario Junior Hockey League, if you do. They look for players that can make quick plays and adapt and play with a bunch of different guys. You never know who you're going to be paired up with on a given night, so best to learn different styles. Sasaki's got it now, looking for his first goal. He'll shoot one, and that one just missed the net. Rogers back in it. Sasaki takes a huge hit right there in his own, in the offensive zone, but the play's kept alive by Vanker. Johnson will throw it in. Reed back on it. He will play it to this side. Prez. And a little bit of hesitation there from Rogers, so the puck comes out. Pinch by Johnson doesn't work. And here come the Coyotes. A shot, and Woods once again makes a stop. He's lying back on it to ensure that he's got it, and that's a little bit of a defensive breakdown there for the Waxers.
Yeah, it looked like a 2-on-1. And that's going to be number 4 for Richmond Hill. It's a golden opportunity right there. in front of the goalie, and Sebastian was. He's made a couple acrobatic saves. We talk about how he's calm and poised, but sometimes he's got to look really solid. And here is actually number 44. That's Nicholas Early for Richmond Hill, who's a little late there. Couldn't beat Woods.
I like that. Well, the lone defender there was Sasaki, the forward, so the Waxers had two guys in deep and almost paid for it, as Skalid with those big strides is able to elude. He was the only one back. There's DeFonseca back in front, and there's a penalty coming out. That looked like interference. Waxers will have an opportunity to go on another man advantage once the puck's touched, and that one's covered up by Barbuto on the catch, and I believe interference is the call. They call it another cross-check, but he was nowhere near the puck anyways. Doesn't really matter, and it'll be two or less.
As we saw on the shot there, that was Skalid. And he's the one who generates that. And he's going to be not the guy who draws it. It's Reeves who gets knocked down. But it's because of Skalid's great job in the neutral zone to pick away that puck and then get speed. And you saw as the defenseman went for the pinch, couldn't get his man. And that turned Skalid into a very dangerous weapon. And it's going to be Markham on the power play, where they've done pretty well, looking for that elusive third goal.
We don't get the luxury of watching this team a lot, but from what I've seen, I mean, they're pretty strong defensively. They got a good goalie, and they're very dangerous in the offensive zone, so it beats me why they're tied for last, but also that final playoff spot. DeFonseca, that's a great tip, and an unbelievable save by Barbuto. That's a tricky one. As back to help out Keegan Hoover, but it was on the wrong side of the blue, so we got offside on Markham.
Well, if you're going to be a defender, try and get in front of the goalie and don't block his vision there, because it looks like there was a maze of bodies. Try and block a shot. That forced the goaltender to make an exceptional save. Number 34 for the Richmond Coyotes. That's Matthew Barbuto.
I don't think you can blame Barbuto for either goal he's let in tonight. There was the nice hands by Skalid. He's alone in front of the net, and you can't really blame a goalie when there's one guy in front and it's not on your team. And then the one where the net came off, but he really had no chance, had to push across the other side. I don't think anyone could have made that stop. So a strong game from him. He's made a lot of tough stops as the power play for Markham right back on, and a good forecheck allows them to get control for now. DeFonseca was in there. Two Coyotes ran into each other, and it comes back for Logan Hoover. Able to play it deep. DeFonseca for Keegan. He'll take a shot stop by Barbuto. The rebound! Barbuto made the save. No one knows where it is. Is it in? Referee says no. You see it in the blue paint there. That was an unbelievable chance. And Skalid almost had his second backhand goal in tight.
Well, the Hoovers are so great. They complement each other. And they're putting on that first unit on the power play. And you see the first one gets a shot on that. Then it's Logan following up. And an excellent save made by Barbuto. You saw athleticism from Sebastian Woods on the other side. And here's Barbuto. He's got a sprawl. I don't know how this puck doesn't go in. It looked like it was there for the taking. But you got to give credit to the Hoovers. They complement each other so well and nearly scored on the power play.
Baker holds it in. He'll try and send it to the corner, but there was a bunch of players in that way of that one, so they weren't able to get a deep. Frost is now battling in there as well. Baker trying to dig it out. And it's coming back the other way. Here's an opportunity. Shot by and stopped by Woods. Throws out that blocker aggressively and sends it to the corner. Crawford's on it now. 30 seconds remaining on this Markham man advantage, where they look to increase their lead to a 3-1 lead. Charlie DeFonseca, their captain, but they're just in a step early. I believe Reeves was offside.
Yeah, it was Reeves there on the left side who got in just a step early. But it was DeFonseca with all that speed, and it looked like it could have been opportunity coming the other way. So close on those offsides. Well, and you got to credit to the linesman who have to make that split-second decision. And it was a good call. His faceoff was going to be taken out of the blue line.
DeFonseca is just so fast. His teammates are expecting him to get in the zone before he does. So compliments to him, but obviously got to be more aware, especially on the man advantage, which is down to 12 seconds now. Another scrum in the corner on the power play. A common theme with these special teams on both sides. Coyotes will send it the length, and that should do it. Woods out to get it. And a successful kill for Richmond Hill as Rogers back to get it. Teams are back at even strength. Mewa on the forecheck, as is Santia. Markham's had their hands full defensively when this line's out there for sure. Another huge hit and another penalty. Santia getting a little too over-aggressive in this period.
Well, Santia got that first hit in behind the goaltender, and then that second one is the one that results in the penalty. You can't hit a guy on the numbers or label him by the back into the windows, and that time Niwa got a little too aggressive there. And initially, like, he was going to be taken off. Could have just been a stoppage of play there.
And when a team has an advantage and can throw out the star power that Markham can throw out, you know, you got to be careful of what you're doing, especially if an extra hit, you got to think, is that really worth being short and putting this amazing power play on the ice? But doesn't matter right now, as Markham gets an opportunity on the man advantage. DeFonseca missed that pass, and it's sent down low. Baker breaks it up, plays it down for Johnson, as they got to try and get out of their own zone and get set up in the offensive zone. 30 seconds gone by in this man advantage. Nothing doing so far, but they'll get set up here. Baker shades off the forechecker, tries to find an outlet, and finds Reeves, who finds his captain, DeFonseca, having another strong game. Back for Reeves. He fell down. No call. Baker will find the open man, Johnson, at the point. He's got to play it down low. DeFonseca in there. So is Frost. Reeves. Different personnel on this power play than we're used to seeing. No Hoovers with the Charlie DeFonseca as a centerman. So now they'll try and get that change. Put the Hoovers over the bench. And we're down to under a minute on this man advantage. Here's Baker. Pierce Baker. Seen him shoot the puck a number of times tonight and come awfully close. Scarlett again having another solid game. He'll come in and lay his check on Eliopoulos. Back for Keegan Hoover. He's got Newman at the point, feeds him. Newman back for Keegan Hoover. Newman gets open, gets the pass, the shot. Traffic in front of the net might have hit Scarlett, but the Coyotes send it the length of the ice. Woods way out to play this one. He's got to be careful. He almost gave that one away, but Newman back to keep it. 20 seconds remain on this man advantage. Markham Waxers look to extend their lead to a 3-1 lead here in the second period. Huge game for both teams. Who will pull ahead of the other in the standings after tonight? That's what we'll find out. Keegan Hoover, as the man advantage is over. The shot by Crawford's blocked by Eliopoulos. And Santia out of the box. You got to think that he's going to want to stay out of the box now after taking two minors.
Yeah, took two minors. His coach is probably telling him, no more bad hits. Play much more defensively and more disciplined.
That's the kind of player he is, though. He's a very, very tough and grindy player. He can score some goals. He gets in on the forecheck. Isn't shy to lay the body. And, he, you know, we've seen him shoot the puck a number of times tonight. He's been dangerous in the offensive zone.
That's why you want him on the ice. You don't want him off the ice taking those minors.
That's a good point. Played back up. Barbusa lost it to Sasaki, but Richmond Hill able to get it. Laffey will swing it over for his partner and back for Barbusa. He'll throw it up too far ahead of Lindsay. Willard's going to get there first. Play for Sasaki down low in his own zone. Vanker did just get that one out. Good battle right there at the blue line, but Markham able to push it out and get the draw.
Well, it was a big penalty kill right there by Richmond Hill. Markham scores that goal at the end of the second period. They got all kinds of momentum. But one thing I noticed on that power play, what Richmond was doing to kill the penalty, they were loading up down low. They're not worried about the shots from the point beating him. They're worried about the forwards like DeFonseca and the Hoovers down low. So maybe if you're Markham, try and get some pucks from the point. Maybe try and direct some opportunities on that.
Yeah, trust your goalie. Block out the front of the net. And the rest has been working for them in that regard, but still trailing 2-1. Willard will play it off. Vanker now at the side. Stopped by Barbuto, and another penalty's coming. A lot of penalties being called in this game so far. We saw that last time Markham played as well. Able to draw a lot of penalties and then do the damage on their power play.
Yeah, Markham going to draw it right here, away from the play, getting shoved, and no question, that's interference. You cannot knock your man after the play has already gone away. And Markham with another opportunity. They've had opportunities. When do they capitalize? That's the question. Let's take a look at it again. Oh, that was actually the play previous, and it was a vicious hit. So a lot of physical play, and if you're Richmond Hill right now, you got to make sure that you're doing smart things, because a lot of vicious hits can result in penalties.
Another opportunity for this dangerous power play. That's Hoover giving chase. Keegan Hoover Logan's out there as well. Johnson will play it down low. Logan's got it now up top for Johnson. He's got DeFonseca open on the other side. Now they force it towards the middle. Took an unfortunate hop, so the Coyotes, Adam Mua will cross center, flip it in, and they'll get a quick change. Beginning of these power plays haven't been able to generate much in the second period. In the first period, we did see them generate it right off the draws, but not able to do it right now as Hoover's got it. Keegan Hoover moving in. The backhand just missed wide. Another opportunity stopped by Barbudo. Coyotes are going to send it the length once again. Not good enough puck retrieval and support for this Waxers power play. Johnson for DeFonseca, and that's an errant pass, and now an opportunity. Rodas the shot, looking for his second. Woods says no. DeFonseca on it now, crosses the blue line. He'll just take a shot. That one's kicked out by Barbudo. Back in there now, Reeves the try, stop, rebound, and Barbudo's got it. Not getting a lot of help, but he's definitely held up his end.
Well, that was an incredible save right there. It looked like that puck was gonna go in. Brody Wooler is player for Markham, who had that golden opportunity, and it was stopped. Unbelievable save. But what I want to mention before that is this whole power play is set up by Charlie DeFonseca. It's getting a little too predictable. Charlie DeFonseca coming up the ice. Maybe they start with their defenseman. Maybe you get that first pass. Here's the opportunity in front, and it's going to be number 7 for the Markham Waxers there. Actually, that's Brody Woolard, and just an incredible save there.
Scrum on the power play, down to half a minute remaining on the Waxers' man advantage. Unable to get that insurance marker as we sit at a 2-1 game here. 3:37 remaining in the second. Wide open in front, Willard the shot, and what a block. That's an unbelievable block to negate the chance in front of the net. Now Santia, he's got a man with him. Santia's going to take it himself, though. Dipsy doodles, and a great play by Willard, but apparently the referee didn't agree with it and didn't think it was clean, so now he's going to head to the box for a slash and will play 4-on-4 for 9 seconds until the Coyotes get their man advantage.
Well, it's Gabriel Sorrentino, the defenseman. Doesn't have a point on the year, but boy, does he sacrifice his body. That is an unbelievable block because he may have just saved a goal there. And how athletic do you have to be to block a shot like that? That puck was actually off the ice, so he had to stretch his legs out so he can get a skate on it. And you saw him walk to the bench after, but what a big block. And now an opportunity, two-man advantage. So it doesn't get any better than this for Markham to try and blow this game out of the water in the second period.
Play goes the other way after the block, and then they're able to draw a penalty. So a double whammy for the Waxers. Oh, so close to tie, to giving themselves a two-goal lead, and now they take a penalty of their own, played down low, as they're going to get their power play out on the ice right now. Rogers was being hounded. They're going to whip it down the ice. So now both teams can get the personnel that they want for this huge man advantage. Eliopoulos behind his own net. 2:56 remaining in a 2-1 hockey game in the second period. Reed back on it. Deliberately takes it to the corner and behind the net shades off Rogers. Now there's some support down low. Another scrum. But the Coyotes emerge with it. That's a nice play. Back in front. Stopped by Woods. He did get a piece of that, I believe. That's a huge stop to keep this 2-1. Defense needs to be a little bit more aware for the Waxers, though.
It does, but I'm looking at number 27, Ethan Eliopoulos. He was wide open on the left side. Nobody even thought about him.
Back the other way. Reeves, the shot. Stopped by Barbudo. Frost on it now. Under a minute remaining on this man advantage. Reeves just took a hit right to the head. No call. That one looked dangerous. He is slow to get up. I don't blame him. That's a dangerous hit. Rodas centers one. It hit off of Frost. Almost an own goal. Back for Sure. He'll play it. A nice pass. Shot is stopped by Woods. They can't clear it out, though. Getting it back is Schuckster. The blast. And no screen right there, so Woods able to see it. Make the stop. Baker trying to get this puck out. Now the Waxers can't. Back for Sure. Makes a nice move around Frost. Can't get it to the net. Man advantage about to expire. Barbusa off the boards. Willard's back on the ice. We're even, almost broke that pass up. And now he's a fresh man out there. Maybe try and get an extra burst of speed from him, but now there's a scrum in the corner. He almost intercepted that one coming out of the box. We're down to just about a minute remaining in this second period. A close one, a low-scoring one, as we predicted. And we're down to exactly a minute remaining now in this period. You know, Richmond Hill, they've had their opportunities, but they can't seem to really figure out Sebastian Woods besides that one goal. How are they going to get that equalizer?
Well, they got to look to their stars, like Miwa, who you just saw in the last shot. He was good, but on that power play, Shaw was excellent. He's the right winger, and he did a great job of passing that puck down low, got it back to the defenseman up top. That's what you need, good playmakers if you want to win.
And that comes off once again, but Keegan Hoover there to break up the play in the middle. I like how their forwards come down low. Their forwards play a complete game, you know, in all three zones, just so strong. It really beats me why this team has been struggling this year. You see so many strengths from them. But that's another one right there. Their defensemen being very defensively responsible. You see it from Sasaki. You see it from both Hoovers, DeFonseca. They're always in the corners battling and helping out their defensemen.
Yeah, it kind of does baffle me too, because the last time we saw this team, they looked defensively responsible. Today they look defensively responsible. And Sebastian Woods looks great. So you kind of wonder why they are where they are in the standings. But then again, they are playing against a team who's of similar caliber as they are. So, and just to mention, these moorings have come up, and that's quite a bit in this game. As we get about the sixth mooring off the net, probably this game alone.
Well, they've looked good both times that we've seen them. That must mean we're their good luck charm, because they've played essentially perfect games when we've seen them. Really low-scoring, tight hockey games. But, you know, they came on top the first game. They're on top right now. And doing the little things right, they really, really look like they're a very detailed team, as it's played back in for Shuckster. Good forecheck once again by Markham, and then throwing his man down was Berlin. Logan Hoover out there. Berlin playing with the Hoovers, and that's got to be complimentary for him. Up for early. Rogers will throw it in for Laffey. 30 seconds to play in this period. We'll have a flood, and then don't forget to come back for the third period. Should be a great one. Might have gotten away with him. Nope.
He did. That was should have been an offside call.
But it was thrown back in by their own man. I don't believe it was. Either way, we're still playing here, and we got 10 seconds remaining. Plays in the Coyotes zone, but they're trying to get something here. Here's Ryan Lindsay back on it. Lindsay across center will throw it in. That one was ripped. Rogers back to get it. Now he will just kill time. Takes a hit at the end. But we are sitting at a 2-1 Markham Waxer lead after two periods. The strong play of Sebastian Woods, the go-ahead goal by Logan Hoover, that's the difference right now.
Yeah, good goalie play from Sebastian Woods. He made a couple of very acrobatic saves. We see a lot of power plays from both these teams. And interesting, Phil Keston said that coming into this game, it was going to be a power play heavy game, and that both these teams like the special teams, but it hasn't worked so far.
Let's step aside. Don't forget to join us for the third period, a 2-1 game. It's a close one. It's going to be a good one. Rogers TV's got you covered. Stay tuned.
As you take a look at some highlights from the first two periods, just in case you guys weren't caught up on all of them. So this is what went down. Markham coming up to an early lead. Then it was the Richmond Hill Coyotes who got on the board, and then DeFonseca for Skold. And here's in the second period here. Opportunity here for Markham, and that was a beautiful goal, as you saw the big man Skold showing off those hands. And we start play here in the third period. Very important 2 points on the line, as I send over to Zach Bodenstein.
Thank you, Harlan. Huge 2 points on the line tonight, as Markham leads Richmond Hill 2-1 here, 15 seconds into the third period. And I think the storyline, if you're going to pick one storyline from this incredible game from the first two periods, should be both goaltenders. Both goaltenders have faced a lot of high-danger shots, but they've been excellent.
Yeah, I was going to say, Woods has particularly been the best player, in my opinion. And the other goalie as well has been excellent, Matthew Barbuto for Richmond Hill. Yeah, the goalies have been excellent. We talked about this high-powered offense with Markham and even Miwa for Richmond Hill. And none of these guys have really done a ton of damage. The Hoovers did get a goal, and so did Skold, but for the most part, it's been the goaltenders.
Richmond Hill doesn't score a lot of goals. Sebastian Woods doesn't surrender a lot, so it will be interesting to see how they figure him out here in the third period. Is DeFonseca back for it? Markham's captain will flip it back out. Miwa on it now. Their top scorer, as a slash there, is going to be called. I thought maybe they got away with it for a second, but now they're going to be shorthanded early. A big test for Woods, who's been so good over the first two periods, and now he's going to have to face a Richmond Hill power play.
As you take a look at it on the replay here, no question, there's a slash. Laffey loses his stick. Can't do that. Laffey generating a lot of speed up the middle, and the only way you can shut him down is not by taking his body, but by taking a stick. That's the wrong call. And 2 minutes or less power play time here for Richmond Hill.
I never understood why players go down on a stick. Why not just go up and lift the stick up? I mean, when I was playing, I would never go down. I would always go up. It just makes a lot more sense for me. You don't take the penalty, and lifting the stick's always more effective than going down, because if they drop it, all they're going to do is call a slash, and if you're able to lift it up, then, I mean, there's no really harm in that. So Miwa back to get it now on the man advantage. Nifty little player, looks like Patrick Kane, number 88, just spearing up the ice like that on the man advantage. Santia threw it in. Johnson's the first one there, though.
Kane also number 88 for his Blackhawks.
Nice saucer pass, but a little bit too saucy for Eliopoulos, who will bank it off the boards for Miwa. And now Lindsay's on it for Santia. Lindsay, that top line out there representing the power play unit for Richmond Hill. Sure, will throw it in. Rogers was in the way. Scrum for it now. Markham would like to pin the puck and just get that whistle. Richmond Hill wants to set something up here. Seems like we're getting close to a whistle, though. Now, pinning.
This is the strategy for Markham, just trying to take away as much time as possible. And refs will finally, the linesman will blow the whistle, but that's a good job by Markham. Nothing doing. That's what you want to have happen here.
They killed off about 15 seconds with that. I mean, that's got to be effective. It's essentially a clear, right? And the only negative is that you got an offensive zone draw, or defensive zone draw if you're Markham, but definitely a good kill right there.
Absolutely.
15 seconds.
Just as effective as dumping that puck in. And you can't, that whistle on that play is a little bit unpredictable. You never know whether the linesman's going to call it, unlike on the icing.
But you still got 30 seconds to kill here. Coyotes looking for the equalizer. That would knock this game at 2, but they trail 2-1 right now. Huge game taking place right now. One of these teams will move into a playoff spot tonight, representing the fourth one. Woods overcommitted, but it just hopped over the Richmond Hill player's stick, and then it's sent all the way down the ice to Eliopoulos. 17 to play, and the Waxers now at even strength. A good kill for them. Barbusa will flip it in after taking a hit from Berlin. Willard will backhand this one up, but not out. Willard throws it back for Keegan Hoover. Hoover on the boards. Hoover bodies his man off the puck. They whip it back now. Rodas, he has the only goal tonight for Richmond Hill. That one's centered in front, and that one missed. Good forecheck here after the penalty kill. After the lost chance on the power play. Seems like they have some momentum regardless. There by Keegan Hoover. Here's Early right now, and he just lost a handle on the puck. Early's got a man open to the point, but he plays it in front, and that one just missed. Equalizer was right there. Keegan Hoover, responsible for that giveaway, banks it up for his brother Logan. Logan's down low in the half boards, he'll swing it back. Keegan being pressured by the defender. So strong and calm on the puck, though. Plays it up top and still has it. Now he'll throw it down low. His brother Logan for Crawford, and Logan gets it back. Logan for Keegan. Nice display of chemistry right here between the two brothers. Sasaki now on the ice with them. He pinned that puck, and now Keegan's on it. Sasaki in there to help out. Coyotes come away with it. early at the end of a shift, will just flip it in, and he continues to chase this puck. Woods has to make a play. He does to Sasaki, and the Coyotes get a change in. Sasaki will play it up right back for Santia. Just over 15 minutes remain in this game, a 2-1 hockey game. A lot of time for the Coyotes if they're thinking about equalizing this one, but they ice it, and a faceoff's coming back to their own end.
Yeah, very fast-paced period. Doesn't look like any team wants to give the opponent anything, playing very defensively. We did see that gorgeous opportunity in the Markham zone, but other than that, it's been very defensive as we take a look at the goalies. Both have been excellent. Woods for Markham, and that shot was Barbuto. He's been excellent. 2-1 hockey game. Both these teams don't score a lot of goals, but the question is, who's going to get those extra 2 points? As you mentioned, those 2 points would put the winner of this game into a playoff spot for the time being.
And you speak about both teams not scoring a lot of goals, so how important is that miss on the power play? They weren't able to generate anything, really. And another penalty coming here. I think they're going to get another power play. So how important are these power plays for a team that's goal-challenged and been goal-challenged all year long in a big game?
Well, they're huge. But right now it's going to be very hard to beat these goalies. What I would recommend on these power plays, maybe try and load up your point men, because we know how much emphasis there are on the Hoovers and DeFonseca and Skold. Maybe try and generate offense through another way. Maybe creating traffic, as we see there behind the play. There is a lick by the Markham player, and he actually just went down. Almost sat on him a little bit. So, a power play coming up for Richmond Hill. And this opportunity to get back in the game, maybe their best opportunity of this game.
They weren't able to score on the one to start the third period, and now they get one 5 minutes in. A huge power play here in a really, really big game. Adam Miwa back to get it now. Again, flying through that neutral zone. He's going to try and get an entry. Rogers with a step up, but he's able to get the puck in. DeFonseca back defensively. Points left wide open. They'll whip it back. Eliopoulos tries for that backdoor feed. Miwa threw it in front. Puck comes up in the air. Two players joust for it, but Miwa able to recover. Eliopoulos, that one almost came out. And he gets the return pass. The shot, it hit two legs. And then a stop by the legs of Sebastian Woods. On the spot, as usual. Eliopoulos looks at the net, but then able to pass it off. Miwa, one too many passes. They weren't able to get the puck at the net. You would have liked to see a shot there as the Coyotes clear the puck, The Coyotes go back after the cleared puck.
Yeah, one too many passes, try and get the puck on net. And that was Scher who passed it up to Muon. Maybe just try and get the puck on net. Yeah, Muon's been generating so many opportunities, but you're in that tight, get the puck on net.
Here's an opportunity, an on-man rush. They drop it to Eliopoulos. The blast and stopped by Woods once again. Fine performance from Sebastian Woods tonight, as he's been doing all year long, keeping his team in hockey games. Although the Waxers have actually had a really good performance tonight, but just leading 2-1. Scullion will throw it back. Eliopoulos, the drive. That one's blocked in front. And he'll get the return pass. Shuckster looks past the shot, and what a stop by Woods diving across. That's great. Lateral movement by Sebastian Woods. And then bounces over Eliopoulos' stick and comes out. That's a game saver right there.
Absolutely. That's so much harder than it looks, because he actually has to move his pads while he's on the ground from right to left. That takes so much skill and determination from a goalie and strength to be able to move your body from right to left.
Nice power slide there. And now DeFonseca, as the teams are back at even strength. A dangerous looking power play at times, but not able to generate anything. They stay onside. There's an opportunity, and it hit the outside of the net. The net comes off once again. And that was Rodas, their goal scorer, bidding for a second one.
And we're going to take a look at that big save by Woods. He's been so good today, and this was spectacular because that pass was perfect, and he had the goalie beat on the play, or so it looked, and he just got over and saved what would have been the goal that would have tied this game up. So Woods, we talked about how special he was in the first two periods. He's continued it in the third.
What makes that play tougher also is that he's looking towards the net and then passes it off. As a goaltender, you can't cheat and expect that pass, especially when the player's looking towards the net. So, he's expecting shot, gets the pass. He's still able to slide across and be equal to the task. So Sebastian Woods living up to his expectations tonight. He's got to catch the eyes of some scouts as we get later on into this season, do you not think?
Absolutely. And this is their draft year. This is such an important year for these guys. Just on that last play, Schuckster looked like he was going to shoot that puck, but he made the pass. That's, as you mentioned, that was so impressive about it because he could not cheat. He had to honor the shooting lane, and instead he was able to still get over there in time.
That's just fine hockey IQ by the shooter, the passer, and the goaltender. Back to the line. The shot is blocked, and Hoover was stepped into, so he wasn't able to break free. Richmond Hill will play this puck in. Woods right out to play it. A little bit of miscommunication, but Crawford on it. His first game in 2 months, coming back from a broken leg. A beautiful outlet pass. Here's a two-on-one. Charlie DeFonseca takes a shot, blocked by Eliopoulos. The two-way defender comes up huge with a block there on Markham's most dangerous player. A huge chance to give this give them a two-goal lead. Willard kept that puck in. The blast is stopped. There's a rebound in front of the net. No one could find it, though, except the Coyotes. We clear it out. Rogers for DeFonseca. Had that great chance and missed. That one's blocked again by Eliopoulos. Paying the price right now. Lindsay on the boards. Ryan Lindsay plays it up for Mua. Woods is going to wisely make the stop, and Mua gave him an extra hack. Willard didn't like it, but face-off coming up in the Markham own, in the Markham zone.
Well, that's what he does. Number 88, the pesky little Adam Mua. Even though the puck shot on net, Adam Mua's looking for the rebound. He's looking for something, and he doesn't mind getting knocked after the play. You take a look at it again. Fired toward the net. Adam Mua, he's looking for a rebound, or he's looking for a loose puck. And Markham says, nah, get out of here.
Intense game like this, you gotta try and rattle the other team somehow. That puck wouldn't have come loose, but why not? Schuckster a try. That one was blocked in front by Baker, and it went in! That's Santia's second of the game, a massive goal. It rolled in front. Woods couldn't find it. It goes behind him, and Richmond Hill has equalized it with 11 to play here in the third.
Santia scored that goal early in the first period. Now we got the second one here. It's a very fluky goal. It takes a bounce off a Markham player. And then that's the importance of what Mua did earlier, trying to capitalize on a loose puck. Here it's Santiwa. The puck was loose, and he just fired it to the short side of the goaltender. Kind of a
fluky
goal.
He's right back on the forecheck, too. Sorry to cut you off, Harlan. That's a big hit by Santiwa all over the puck tonight. That's been exciting to watch. Big winger. And he's using his size to throw around some Markham Waxers. He is just even this game at two. He's got both goals for the Coyotes tonight. He's been a player to watch all night long. Rodas had the first one. Santia had the second one, but Santia's been all over the net. I think he might have registered a point on that first one as well, but just an unbelievable performance from him.
Right. Now you wonder what's the bounce back going to be like. We talked about shifts after goals. Well, that was a very short shift. Let's see what happens here. But I'm looking for some bounce back from Richmond Hill from Markham, because they've been dominated consistently for the last 2 minutes.
And they haven't gotten a lot of shots in this period as we approach the halfway mark of it. And a period which they started with the lead, have squandered, and now we're tied in this massive game. A playoff spot for the time being is on the line tonight. One of these teams will get in, of course, unless there's a tie. Rogers, the shot! And that one just got tipped wide. Keegan Hoover tried to center. Logan Hoover came in to pinch. And now 2-on-2, they skate. Barbusa will flip it in. Woods steers it aside. Can't blame Sebastian Woods for that last goal. Just an unlucky bounce. Great persistence, though, by Santia.
Absolutely. No chance on the goal. He came out to play the puck. Just bad luck, as you mentioned.
Trying to dance his way in. But Chaffee doesn't have anything of it. Played back to the corner. Coyotes looking off ice. Willard just keeps that in with a diving play. But the Waxers will go on a change. At least Hoover will stay back out there. Great play by Willard to keep the play alive, at least for a second. Now a misplay by Scullett taking over. Tried to find Hoover in front. Keegan Hoover couldn't get stick on puck. Willard throws it off the outside of the net. Keegan Hoover tries to center. End of a long shift for him. But DeFonseca holds it in. Keegan Hoover gloves it down on one knee. He'll find the open man. That's Rogers. Rogers will play it for DeFonseca. That one's a tip play, but just missed from Keegan Hoover, who's still out there. after this long shift, but Markham keeps the pressure alive, and Rogers keeps it alive right now. DeFonseca plays it down low. Keegan Hoover tried to dive it across, playing it for Stolid, but didn't get enough on it. As the Coyotes, desperate to clear, they will just slap it down and take the icing for the change. But there's that shift from Markham after giving up the tying goal, gaining their momentum back and trying to take over this game again.
Oh, it was an outstanding shift. And we saw how they kept the puck in. And at the line there, we saw a diving effort to keep the puck in. And then it was DeFranceca along the far side left wall. They just did such a great job. Defensemen pinching up, anything that needed to be done, and it almost generated into a scoring opportunity.
8:40 remains in this game. Recently a 2-2 game. Here's Early now with one man back. It's Baker. Early will just try a shot that almost fooled Woods. That puck had some magic on it. Baker now being outworked in the corner. Sasaki couldn't get in there as well. Reed on the forecheck. He hits Baker. Good forecheck here from the Coyotes, but Baker has got it for Sasaki. Couldn't catch up to it, and Sciarra's got it now. Sciarra will just flip this puck in for Baker, who takes another check. But the puck's able to be cleared. It hopped over the skate of Eliopoulos, so no icing. Back to get it now is Santia. The reason why we're tied right now, that persistence in front of the net, pays off. As here's Logan Hoover on the turnover. Hoover wraps it around. Stopped by Barbudo. Cleared off the boards. Markham starting to find their legs a little bit. And that was courtesy of a turnover in the Coyotes zone. Centering pass broken up by Eliopoulos. And he'll just skate it to center, get it in, and get off. A great play by him to break up a chance and then get the change. Rogers being hounded. Mew is in there as well, but Rogers able to emerge with it behind his own net. 7:15 remains in this hockey game. You'd love to get the W and not settle for a tie, considering how tight the standings are at this point. You don't want that other team picking up another point. You want to get two for yourself. So an absolutely massive last 7 minutes. That shot was just missed wide by Keegan Hoover. Scarlett again on the forecheck. This Markham forecheck going back to its roots, creating turnovers. That's got to be a strength for them tonight.
Definitely. They're taking away pucks in the opponent's zone and creating chances right in the slot.
Willard on the boards will force it down low for Scarlett, who reversed it to no one. And the Coyotes now with more pressure on from Markham. Lindsay plays it up. Skillian couldn't quite catch up to it. That was a great play by Johnson to knock it away. And the up pass springs a 3-on-2. DeFonseca with Scarlett as the trailer, and he couldn't find him cleanly. Play was broken up by Eliopoulos. Seems like he's double shifting at this point. Really effective defender. That one bounced in front of the net. That was a weird bouncing puck. Crawford will throw it down low. DeFonseca left it. Laffey over there being hounded by Reeves. Under six to play in a 2-2 hockey game. DeFonseca dancing around. Made a pretty nice move. Found the open man. There's Crawford. Shoots. Blocked up and out of play. That would have been a dandy. But what vision by Charlie DeFonseca.
Charlie DeFonseca. We've seen the speed from him in this game, but he's been kind of quiet in this third period. Known as a guy who generates a lot of opportunities, and that time it was the pass. We see the playmaking skills on display by the big, strong centerman. Gave his man a great pass in the slot. It's all about vision, like you said.
Yeah, 16 points in 12 games for Charlie DeFonseca, but only four of those are goals. So 12 assists in 12 games, and clearly you can see why. The guy is unbelievable at finding his teammates. As falling down is Barbudo, and now Markham back on and looking to take advantage. Johnson will throw it down low. Here's Sasaki, tries the back pass, and it eluded everyone, and actually sprung a breakout pass. Here's Prez with a man back. Johnson steps up beautifully with help from Crawford. They're able to negate that chance. That was almost a terrible break for the Markham Waxers. Being held into the boards is Vanker, and I believe that they will call the hold. Pretty blatant hold, and they will. So now a huge opportunity for the Markham Waxers to score a go-ahead goal with 5:08 remaining. Tie game. We know how huge the points are in this crucial one.
Opportunity on the power play. 5 minutes left. Maybe the best chance you're going to get here. And I want to see a lot of pucks towards the net. I don't want to see any dipsy doodling. Keep it simple, keep it sharp, and just go right as soon as this power play starts. Looks like we might be calling a timeout here.
Yeah, Charlie DeFonseca throws up the tee to the official, and now a timeout for Markham. And that just kind of shows, you know, 5 minutes left, close game, a power play opportunity, and your faceoff, the faceoff's just outside the blue line. So that just shows how big this game is and speaks to how big the opportunity is for this team right now.
Yeah, it does. And it also shows Charlie DeFonseca, he's the one that called that timeout. So his coach must have some confidence in him if he's letting one of his players call the timeouts. But as you mentioned, yeah, this is going to be a huge power play. And Markham calling the timeout. You need a score here or generate some momentum. This is a big goal, big opportunity in the game, because after this, it'll be 3 minutes left. And for whoever team is losing at that point, they may have to pull their goalie. So as you mentioned, huge game right here, trying to get into a playoff spot, and good time to take the timeout.
It'll be Adam Miwa on the draw against Logan Hoover. What is Richmond Hill going to have to do to keep Markham off the scoreboard?
Well, look to take away chances from Skold, because he's been awesome. So look for Skold in the slot, and look for Charlie DeFonseca maybe somewhere along the sides, because he's going to try and find someone up the middle.
Here's a chance. Santia moving in for a second. A shot! He hit the post! Shorthanded opportunity. That could have been bad. A perfect entry, a bad giveaway, good persistence by Miwa, and that was almost a 3-2 game for the shorthanded team. Santia almost had a second, then he tries to feed Miwa, and it was just out of the reach of him. And now Miwa goes crashing into the Markham net. That was very, very close. Santia had him beat, just couldn't beat the iron.
Well, Santia is a big man, but he's also takes huge strides, and we're going to take a look at the replay as Santia has just a glorious opportunity, and he had the goaltender beat, no doubt about it, on the short side. A nice wrist shot, and just didn't work for him. But you love to see the speed, and you love to see a guy who's taking chances. He knows the opportunity is there for the taking in a 2-2 tie. He's looking to give his team a lead.
He's been all over the game tonight, whether it's taking penalties or creating scoring chances, delivering big hits. I mean, he's been a catalyst for this team. Besides those two minors, he's definitely led the way for them. As DeFonseca on that entry, Markham looks to get set up on this power play, a big power play that only sees a minute left. They haven't been able to generate anything. The story of this man advantage was the shorthanded break by Santia, and just smacked it off the post. Here's Rodas. He has the other goal for them, and he'll make a nifty move back around, and Woods stays square to it, but that's a clever move by Rodas to get around the defender.
It's a very clever move, and it's a very hard move to pull off. Usually you don't see that in minor midget hockey here, but on the one-on-one, very skilled play. Couldn't beat the goalie, and give credit to Sebastian Woods, because as you said earlier, he does a great job of moving laterally from right to left. And you might have thought in that situation that Rodas may have tried and gone for the shot top shelf or something, but does a nice job of staying with him and taking away that short side.
Of course, the negative implications of having a forward back on the power play is that if something like that happens, Logan Hoover, not a typical defenseman, but he keeps his body in the way, and Woods slides over to make a good stop. Just 30 seconds remain in this power play now. They haven't generated anything. A very aggressive and dominant forecheck by the Coyotes has resulted in a pretty good kill so far, but there's still 20 seconds left. Crawford swings it over. Here's Frost. He's got an opening, but he'll take it. That one's blocked. Crawford now shoots, and seeing it through, rebound. He saw it through the screen, made the stop, and then made the stop in front of the net as well. And again on the forecheck, Barbusa. Woods will come out and swing it to Baker. That was an unbelievable stop by Barbudo. He looked around the defenders, and there were a bunch of them, and he's able to make the stop at the pad. What a job by him. Now we're even. 2:55 remains in this game, and the Waxers ice the puck. It seems like Richmond Hill got some momentum off of that kill, something we didn't expect to happen.
And here it is on the replay. Just an amazing save by Barbuto. Oh my gosh, he made that with his boot. Just like his name implies, Barbuto, he made that with his leg. And he was on the ground. I don't know if he knew where that puck was, because his eyes were certainly not on the puck. But it's about good positioning and, more importantly, athleticism. He's able to sprawl out like that. Shows out how athletic he is.
Connor Berlin so close there as Woods makes the save. You know, you'd like Berlin to raise that puck up a little bit, but it's easier said than done when you're in tight like that. You don't have a good grip on the stick, and he just slides it right into the pad. But great positioning by Matt Barbuto. Keeps Markham at two goals. He's been very strong. We talk a lot about Sebastian Woods tonight, but I think he's been almost equally as good.
I think he's been equal to the task. I think early on I would have given it to Woods, but he's really upped his game here in the third period.
See if Richmond Hill can dominate for the remainder of this game. They definitely did so on their penalty kill. As Scherz got it now in his equipment, plays it down low, but Logan Hoover on it. They'll flip it back in, and Rogers with some forechecking on him. The long lead pass for Berlin, who had that brilliant chance earlier. Schuchter plays it away for Willard, and up blowing a tire there was Prez. He had an opportunity to break away and just fell as Laffey's got it. Now 2 minutes remain in this hockey game, a 2-2 hockey game right now. Very, very big, very big points at stake. And one chance could define a season. You never know. Schuchter up. Here's an opportunity. Barbuto in there. He'll take the shot off the post again. That was a heck of a shot. Puck luck not there right now for Richmond Hill. Two glorious chances that beat Woods, but not the iron. And something like that could make an entire difference in a season, but just unlucky right there.
Well, they've had the most of the scoring chances here in the third period. Here we see speed along the far side. It's a 2-on-1. Doesn't elect to pass. Goes for the shot, and he's got Woods beat on the glove hand. Just an electric shot, and it misses on the outside of the post. There's a timeout going to be called here by Richmond Hill, as the faceoff's going to be in their own zone.
Yeah, I'm sure they want to draw up some sort of play off the draw. You know how important draws are, especially when you're in the defensive zone. You don't want to lose it. And Markham's had really good setups off of draws, whether it's in the neutral zone to get entries or whether they're setting up after an offensive zone draw. So you got to win this draw. And if you lose it, strategize what to do. There's a minute 22 left in this game, and there's no need to gamble it and not take a timeout. You're dominating. So if you're Richmond Hill, you got to win this draw and then get back and dominate for the remainder of this game, because if you give up a goal here, that's an absolutely massive goal and it's possibly a season-changing moment, considering how close the bottom of the standings are. And maybe get on a roll also if you win a game like this. And this has been a very intense game, playoff kind of implications and atmosphere between these two teams. High-tempo game.
I'll be interested to see here what both team strategies are. You know how important a point is, as it would move both of them on top of the Predators, who currently hold on that fourth spot. So I'm looking for maybe some conservative hockey, just to try and get that one point.
Well, the Coyotes do win the draw, but Markham controls. They had a man in front of the net. You don't want to leave Keegan Hoover in front, but fortunately it bounced away from him. Now Santee on the transition with Mua. Tried the return, but a good stick by Crawford, as we're down to just about 1 minute remaining in this game. 2-2. I tell you what, both of these teams deserve a point with these performances, but you'd love to get that extra one. As Reeves is a step offside once again with Hoover on the entry.
It's going to be an exciting final 54 seconds. Which team is going to push it? Are we going to see some neutral zone play? But it's been very exciting so far. And as we see that shot of Barbuto, it reminds us that the goalies have been the ones who have stolen the show tonight here in minor midget AAA hockey.
Neither team wants to settle for the tie, but neither team wants to make that one mistake that might cost them the 2 points, as DeFonseca tries to dance around Eliopoulos. Back on it, Schuchter, as they're going to throw it back up. Willard, every second so important right now. And the remaining minute, not able to get back onside was Barbuto. So the Coyotes are offside with 39 seconds remaining in this game.
Yeah, and the last two offsides to me speak to the fact that the defensemen are trying to load up on the blue line, playing kind of a very defensive game. They're not playing back, they're playing up in the neutral zone, trying to play that defensive wall, not let your opponent get in. And that speaks to the importance of this game. Just try and get a point and move up in the standings.
Markham's been tying a lot lately, and you got to think that, you'd want that second point for sure. I mean, this is a tight league with such congested standings. You definitely want to get that one go-ahead goal, as they're going to try and get it here up for Reeves, but out of his reach. Logan Hoover will flip this one back in. No ice. 16 seconds remain in this hockey game. Shuckster on it now, escaping pressure. He'll play it off the boards. Took a funny hop, and they're not able to get it out, and now they just do get it over the blue line. Back for Johnson. He'll flip it up. Time is going to run out on us, so we have a 2-2 tie as that shot by Logan Hoover at the end almost tested Barbuda, but what an unbelievable performance by both goaltenders. And yeah, they both settle for the 2-2 tie. You'd love to get that extra point. So both teams will be tied for that fourth playoff spot right now. But Markham with the game in hand will officially have it right now.
Yeah, Barbuto was excellent in the third period. Woods was excellent too. Give this game to the goaltenders. We saw 9 goals in our first game here on Rogers TV. Just 4 here. And there were a tremendous amount of offensive opportunities for both these teams. It speaks to just how good the goaltenders were. Athleticism at times from Sebastian Woods, moving from right to left. And we also saw some great stuff from Barbuto.
Well, that'll do it for us on Rogers TV. Our doubleheader is complete. A 2-2 tie between the Richmond Hill Coyotes and the Markham Waxers in minor midget AAA. A great one. Goaltenders duel. And neither team will settle for the win tonight, but there you have it. A very, very good game. And thanks for tuning in on Rogers TV. Be sure to come back and watch some more minor hockey. Zach Bodenstein and Harlan Nemirovsky, thank you for coming as we send you off with our highlight pack.